Hello, fellow rebels. My name is Nate Cohen, and I am currently walking on a roadway that runs from Lakeville Road behind me all the way down to the track in front of me. And, you know, if you've ever played a sport, or honestly, even if you haven't, you've probably walked this roadway yourself at some point in your middle school and high school time during a fire drill, and you probably haven't thought too much about it. But this roadway actually was once part of a major highway that used to run all across Long Island. And its name was the Vanderbilt Motor Parkway. I'm doing this video today because I want to understand exactly what this highway was, why it existed, and what's left of it today. To begin the story of this road, it's probably best to start with the man behind it, Mr. William K. Vanderbilt. Now this was, of course, the grandson of the Mr. Cornelius Vanderbilt, you know, the second richest man in American history. Yeah, that guy. Well, what that meant for William is that he grew up like humongously stupid rich. And when you grow up you're humongously stupid rich, what you do is you spend that money. So, you know, Mr. William K. Vanderbilt, he built a highway because cars were starting to become a thing. And with cars starting to become a thing, people wanted to have car races.
But this car could be systematic, hydromatic, ultramatic. Woo! Why could be Grease Lightning?
Grease Lightning!
Mr. William Vanderbilt ended up organizing some races on public roads, but those proved to be largely unsuccessful because of those reckless spectators who were ruining the races. So Vanderbilt had an idea: build a private road entirely of his own land, free of police, speed limits, spectators, everything. And he would host his races on this road. And in addition, he would make it a toll road for people to go and take nice leisurely drives and get across Long Island. And boy, was that highway a big deal. It was the first of its kind, the first highway for only automobile use. It cost $2 million to build, but only $2 to use on the toll. It spurred the development of Long Island, to take it from a rural land that looked like this to a suburban land that we all know today. Yes, for years and years and years and years, this highway was a symbol of progress and innovation. Then in the spring of 1938, the highway closed. The highway just wasn't profitable. Vanderbilt knew it was. It had never really been profitable. Vanderbilt had been funding it with his own money just to keep it open, even though it was a money-losing business. For a while, that was okay, but then the Depression hit, and it made even less sense to drive on this road, so you had even less vehicles. Vanderbilt investing more and more money for less and less people to drive it. Then, of course, how could you forget that a new highway was being built, the Northern State Highway that we all know today. And that highway was made by the government, which meant it was free. There were no tolls. So you could drive on the toll highway that was thinner, you know, that was skinnier, that was curvier, that wasn't as in good condition, or you could build on the new highway built by the government that was free. So this highway kind of stopped making sense. And so now, this highway is kind of lost to history. Or is it?
In a simple way, and if you need to know while I'm still standing.
Because today, the highway has a ton of remnants. Like a ton. The parkway is here at Great Neck Sound. This bikeway in Queens. This bridge in New Hyde Park. This stretch of abandoned roadway in Williston Park. This path near Eisenhower Park. This bike path in Bethpage State Park. And in many, many, many other places on Long Island. In other words, while the Long Island Motor Parkway may be long gone as a parkway, it's still very much here in the places you'd least expect.